Hi everyone, my name is Dominic Baloyi. I'm from Obit TVET College in the Northwest. Today we will be doing lessons on professional engineering practice level 4, of which is a subject that is being done by ERD students, engineering and related design students. We will be doing topic 3. Normally this module or this subject is very short, so I believe that given the space or the time that we had when we were having classes, we have covered topic 1, 2. So I'll be proceeding with topic 3, of which is communication in engineering. We've got 2 subject outcomes that we're going to cover today. We're going to do number 1, interpret sketches, graphs, and drawings of engineering structures and mechanisms. Number 2, we're going to do design system representations. Unit 1, it's interpret sketches, graphs, and drawings of engineering structures. Introductions. As engineers, we rely heavily on graphical methods of communication. You know, there's a lot that we do in drawing before we can manufacture or produce articles, or whether it's cars, it's chips, it's aeroplanes, there's a form of drawing that we do. So that is one example of the type of communication that we have as engineers. Another thing with relation to these types of sketches is that they need to be common throughout the world. So we've got a standard that we use when we draw, so that as engineers we can communicate across the globe. The drawings and chart must be produced according to international standards, as I've alluded that the standard is similar throughout, using international symbols and conventions. And then they should suffer no language barriers, meaning that if I'm an Indian person and then I want to communicate to a Russian person, through this schematical representation of information, any person from anywhere in the world will be able to interpret and understand what is being communicated through these sketches or drawings. It must be noted that graphical communication does not replace spoken or written communication, but it does reinforce and complement other means of communication. So identifying different features from given sketches and drawing or graph, we've got mathematical data. This is the presentation of information mostly in graphs. So normally we've got examples of these graphs. The first one, we've got line graphs. They give a clear and convenient way of describing complex components and assemblies. Graphs can be used to give a clear and convenient picture of the mathematical relationship between engineering and scientific quantities. So figure 1.1 shows the relationship between distance and time. From the basic concepts of science, we understand that the relationship between distance and time, it is talking to speed. So how will we represent speed in a graphical context? We have an example there. Figure 1.1, it's talking to the speed graph. There's a blue line that is projecting upwards, and then there's a red line that is projecting upwards, but it then goes into a stationary line. That stationary line is the one that is talking to consistency, meaning that we have constant speed, meaning that the speed is constant. If a car is traveling at 80 kilometers per hour, it means that from 4 seconds to 6 seconds, that car will be traveling at 80 kilometers per hour. But when you look at from 0 to 1 seconds, you can see that the graph is projecting up, meaning that the speed is increasing of that car. When you look at from 1 second to 2 seconds to 3 seconds to 4 seconds, the graph proceeds to go up, meaning that the car is gaining speed, it's gaining momentum. And when you look at the graph represented in the blue color, you can see that it's consistently going upwards, meaning that the speed is just increasing throughout. So that is how you can represent a speed of a car, a speed of a plane, a speed of a train, to show that it is moving at constant speed or it is increasing speed. That is how we can, you know, communicate the relationship between distance and time using a line graph. We have another example called histograms. Histograms are approximate representation of the distribution of numerical or categorical data. An example, we have a histogram in figure 1.2 displaying the relationship between different age groups that visit Cape Town. So to show that it's a categorical data, you've got age groups that are categorized. You've got 0 to 5 years, 5 to 10 years, 10 to 15, 15 to 20, 20 to 25, and so forth. But what we can deduce from these graphs is that we can see that the age group of between 20 to 25 years, it's the highest, meaning that that age group of people, they are the ones that visit Cape Town the most. And then when you look at 0 to 5 years, you can see that normally it's infants, it's the lowest, meaning that they are the ones that visit Cape Town the least. So that is the kind of information that we can represent using histograms. Another example is bar charts. They are used for displaying statistical data. The bars can be plotted vertically or horizontally. The bars can be arranged in any order, meaning that you can have the highest starting to the lowest, or you can have the highest in the middle, whichever way. But if the bars are to be arranged from highest to lowest, they are then called Pareto charts. We've got an example of a bar chart. It is talking to the population of dolphins and whales over a certain period. The period is represented in years. You've got 2017, 2018, 19, 20, 21, and 22. Remember that we are only now at 2020. So when you look at the representation of the population of dolphins and whales, in 2017, we had about 150 whales, dolphins, sorry, and then we had about 80 whales. So, but when you look at 2020, you've got around 15 dolphins, and then you've got around 78 whales, meaning that the population is reducing. So from this information, when you look at from 2017 to 2020, you can see that there is a reduction and sometimes there is a growth. But from here, we can then go on to predict what will happen in the near future. As you can see, according to the graph, that during 2020, we will have less dolphins. Actually, they will even become extinct as we predict. So that is how we display statistical data, of which from this data we can then, you know, predict the future as to what can happen so that we plan properly. Another example is pie charts. Pie charts, they are used to show how the total quantity is divided up into individual parts. We've got an example here, figure 1.4, showing preferred activity from different people. Favorite activities. You can see that if you take a group of 100 people and then you give them options to indicate that which type of activity is favorable, whether it's golf, swimming, cycling, walking, or any other, they can indicate to you, and from those indications you can then deduce according to percentages to say that 12% of people, they prefer golf, meaning that out of 100 you'll be having 12 people that prefer to do golf. Then you'll be having 18 that will be preparing to do swimming, 24 that will prefer cycling, and 40 that will be prefer walking. So from that total number, then you can take it down and reduce it to percentages. And from there, a pie represent 100%. And from there, we can then divide the pie according to the percentages of what favorite activities people want to do or enjoy doing. Then those are schematical representations. Now we're going to come to technical information and drawing. Like graphs, we have considered there are many different ways of representing and communicating technical information. We've got an example of block diagrams. They represent the relationship between various elements of a system. The principal part or functions are represented by blocks connected by lines that show the relationship of the blocks. So in this example, in figure 1.5, the block diagram represent failure mode and effects analysis, meaning that you've got a power pack. A power pack, a typical example can be that of a car. When you have a car and you want to start a car, if the car does not come on, from this block diagram, you can see that it's either you're going to check the generator, the electric motor, or you can go check the engine. But from the engine, it then goes down to say that the fuel system delivery needs to be checked. There's a possibility of that, a possibility of the starter, a possibility of the cooling system. But this is just a block diagram that represents a process that can be followed. So that is how block diagrams are used. Then we've got what we call flow charts. They are used to test the logic of sequence of events. They are used by computer software engineers when planning a new program and by production engineers. Most of you want to see yourselves working in industries, whether it's mining industries or manufacturing industries. Processes will be outlined. Whatever kind of work that you'll be doing will be outlined to you. But this work, when it's represented on flowcharts, there's a specific information that they represent using the shapes. Like here in figure 1.6, when you start a process or a flow of a drilling process, how it starts and how it ends. When you start a process, you can see that you have an oval shape that represents starting. From there, the arrow points down to a process that follows, of which is represented by a trapezium shape. That's where you ask yourself a question that I'm going to start, what is to follow next? And for every decision and for every type of action that you do, you represent it in a rectangular form, meaning that if you are to take a metal piece and then you put it on your workbench, it means that that is a process of you doing the actual activity. So you represent it with a rectangular block. So it continues like that to say that what kind of a material should I use for this purpose? That is the question that you'll be posing to yourself. And then you represent that in a trapezium block. From there you ask yourself, is the material relevant? Is the material enough for the purpose that I'm going to do? Then those are the questions that you'll be asking yourself. Answering yourself and doing, you represent that through the square or rectangular columns. That is how flowcharts go. And that is how in industries you will have information flowing on how to operate a machine, on how to produce a certain article from a machine. You'll have such a flow. So the understanding is very critical to know that each shape, what does it represent? Then we've got assembly drawings. Assembly drawings can be used to represent items that consist of more than one component, meaning that you've got different components or parts that have been put together. Here you've got a tailstock that has been put together, and then it's being represented in three sides, meaning that we've got an orthographic projection. But when you look at this representation of this assembly drawing, they've started with the front, the left, and the top views, meaning that we've got the first angle orthographic projection. From this information, as you are a student, you can see for yourself that all that you are studying in engineering, the information is intertwined. The subjects are intertwined together. What you have learned in drawings now proceeds to come to level 4 in a subject called professional engineering practice, where you're talking about representation of information through what you have learned in your drawing subject, engineering graphics and design. So from this drawings, we can now see that we've got different parts that are being represented here with their names. We've got the type of scale that was used for this drawing. You've got the type of orthographic projection that was used. It's either you can have a first angle orthographic projection or you can have a third angle orthographic projection. So you've got information of who drew the drawing and the date. So if you are to communicate such a drawing to another engineer, they will easily understand what is that you are presenting to them or communicating to them. That is how we represent assembly drawings. Then we've got detailed drawing. Detailed drawing provides all details required to make the component shown on the drawing, meaning that you're going to be informed about everything that has to do with that drawing. Remember that a drawing represents a model or an article. An article, it can be a piece that you produce from lathe machines or from CNC machines. So on this one, we are dealing with, we have another example, which is called detailed drawings. They provide all details required to make the component shown on the drawing. As you can see on this drawing, we've got a well-detailed drawing that represents the scale, the type of the material that was used, the hardness that the material has, the dimensions in millimeters of a special sleeve. Then we've got part numbers, we've got the detail number, you've got the material, you've got the date, you've got the revision, you've got the signature date. So everything that this special sleeve has, it's been represented on a detailed drawing so that you inform the other person that might order that material from you or that component from you so that they can know what type of hardness does this material have, what types of dimensions that does this material have, what type of scale did you use to draw this material so that they can know the actual size of the material. So the following is represented in a detailed drawing. The drawing provides the following information. Number one, the special, the shape of the sleeve, the dimensions of the sleeve, the material from which the sleeve is to be made and its subsequent heat, the unit of measure of which is in millimeters, that is what we use in drawings, the finish, the guidance note, the name of the company. I want to go back to where it's talking about its subsequent heat. Remember that the material, its hardness needs to be communicated. And the type of alloys that were used on the material, they also need to be indicated. In case this material is going to be used in the aircraft manufacturing. Because when you're talking to aircraft manufacturing, your details need to be more. Because in aircrafts, that's where you must try by all means to provide information so that we don't cause accidents through failure of materials because the engineers were using incorrect materials for the purpose of manufacturing or building. Remember that most of the accidents, whether in civil engineering or manufacturing or any other type of engineering, the problem comes when there is no precision. Precision can be lack of information. Precision can be lack of building or supplying equipments that are very accurate. So we need to be specific when we are dealing with such jobs. So we are done with schematic representation graphs. We are now going to move to the next subject outcomes, of which we'll be talking to making a presentation to show understanding of sketches, drawing, or graphs. So when you make a presentation, any other form of presentation, you're going to need support material. So support material, they are going to enhance the type of presentation that you're going to do to your cohort or to the people that you have invited, your clientele. So these are the following guidelines that needs to be considered when you're going to make a presentation. First of all, if you are to make a verbal presentation, you must make sure that you don't use difficult words that you won't be able to pronounce properly, so that you know you don't confuse people when you make your presentation. Make sure that when you are doing verbal presentations, you can repeat yourself if you feel that you did not get the point across. Let your voice be lovely and do not make direct contact or eye contact with your clientele, because sometimes that can cause you to lose focus and for you to be shaky. So you can actually identify a spot where you can look at and then you make your presentation, or you move your eyes around so that you don't keep looking at one consistent position. You can also use the overhead projector as a support material, because today they come in very handy, these overhead projectors, where you need to represent drawings. And if you need to make an explanation or a note on the drawing, it's very easy when you're using overhead projectors for that, because you can write and then project information. And you project it in such a way that people in the room can actually view the bigger picture that you are projecting. Then we've got data projectors. Data projectors, they are usually used in today's times. I think we are all aware of the fourth industrial revolution that is upon us. It has actually arrived. We might be a country that is delaying a bit on that, but as you can see, we are trying to catch up with that. So data projectors are used in today's technology to project information from your laptops, so that when you have a big number of people, you can project information and it can easily be translated to those people. Sometimes you might even have videos that you want to share with people, 3D or 2D videos that you want to, so that you emphasize what you are trying to explain to people through these data projectors. You can also use PowerPoint presentations that will allow the software for you to type your information so that you can present it to people, and then the audience can see your information far much easier, as opposed to only listening to you talking about that information. We also have flip charts. Flip charts can be used for you when you want to add more emphasis to the points that you have highlighted. You can even write formulas, you can proceed to calculate so that you show people and explain to people what you are actually presenting. Then we've got video recordings. They assist us a lot when you are dealing with complex situations that you can not only explain to people, but you can use video so that you enhance the understanding of your audience. Then we also have printed handouts. They will assist you in making sure that your target audience, they concentrate on the information that you are providing, so that they don't take notes as you would have provided what they need to write in those printed handouts. Then technical vocabulary. Technical vocabulary is very important, because in every industry or working environment, there's what we call a jargon. It's the type of language that is used in that particular industry. So you need to talk using the right technical vocabulary. So that is basically it when we're talking to presentations of information in engineering. So another thing that we use is that before we can manufacture anything in engineering, we need to know how to build a model. We have explained a model to say that a model is something that you design that you can actually show to your audience or to your clientele that the final product that you're going to manufacture will look this way. So we normally call it a model, or we can also call it a prototype. Sometimes we even call it a template in engineering. So the model assists in giving a clearer view of what is to be built or manufactured. Architects, together with civil engineers, would normally build a prototype of a complete building together with its surrounding, the gardens, the paving, the parking lots and the like, so that they give an overview to the client of the project that they are buying into. So the following steps are used when building a paper or a CAD model. Number one, you need to start by drawing whatever you want to build. You need to draw using the right scale, using the right instruments. Then secondly, you need to cut the material. If you're going to use a paper or a CAD, you need to cut the material accurately. Then there's what we call scoring. You score the fault lines using a blunt instrument. Sometimes you can use a ruler for that, so that you can fold your paper properly where you're going to cut it. Then there's folding. Folding, it's either you're going to bend or fold the cut paper on the fold lines that you have marked during scoring. Then it will be followed by gluing the shape. Remember that when you glue, you want to make sure that you keep the model together and it is as accurate as possible, so that when you represent it to your clientele, you know it's showing the actual image of what you're going to produce. Then lastly, it's painting. If required, you can paint the model to make it look more realistic. In conclusion, we had two critical outcomes that we have covered. You must now be in position to be able to answer questions that relate to communication in engineering and give examples. So I believe that you are now conversant with the topic of communication. So you can communicate to other engineers using the right methods. So that is the conclusion of our lesson for today. I just want to wish you good luck and to stay safe. And you must always know that together we shall conquer this epidemic. Thank you.